Welcome to Microbial Concepts, and we are going to learn about evasion today. This topic comes under microbial pathogenesis. These are the determinants for microbial pathogenesis. So there is already one video on adhesion and colonization and invasion. So I will mention the link in description box and you can check it out there. And then this is the third point in determinants, which is evasion. This is nothing but how pathogens escape the immune response of host system. Okay, so these are some ways or methods used by pathogen to evade the host immunological response. They are listed below. And now we will start our topic. These are some examples listed, which will give you an idea about how bacteria are now inherently able to resist the bactericidal components of host tissue. For example, the capsule of Bacillus anthracis, which contains poly-D glutamate, it protects the organism from cell lysis by cationic proteins in sera or in phagocytosis. Okay, so this capsule plays a main role here by protecting the bacteria from getting phagocytosed. Next is the gram-negative bacteria, which has the outer membrane, which acts as a permeability barrier for hydrophobic compounds such as bile salt. Next example is about the intact polysaccharides, which are LPS of gram-negative pathogens, may protect the cells from complement-mediated lysis. Complement-mediated lysis or the action of lysozyme. So I hope you know about the complement mediated lysis. This is the system which has two cycles or pathways. One is a classical and other one is alternative pathway, which ends up by forming pores in cell wall, and thus the permeability is, what we can say, it is altered, and it leads to cell lysis. So first main point which we will be studying in evasion is overcoming host phagocytic defenses. Okay, so when an organism invades host tissue, it is first and foremost exposed to phagocytes. I hope you all know what are phagocytes. Phagocyte consists of cells such as neutrophils, monocytes and macrophages. A pathogen is successful when it can resist or escape this first line of immune response. There are many diverse strategies developed by these microorganisms or pathogens to avoid the phagocytic killing. So what are these strategies? They are nothing but they will block one or more steps in phagocytosis. Okay, so first we will see what are the steps included in phagocytosis. Okay, first is when an organism invades host tissue, the phagocyte will get signals and they will make contact between the microbial cell. So first step is contact between phagocyte and microbial cell. Second is when the contact is made, they will engulf the bacteria or pathogen. Okay, and after engulfing, the phagocytic cell will form phagosome. So what is phagosome? On ingestion of a particle or bacteria by phagocyte, a vesicle is formed around it. It is also known as vacuole. Okay, so this is formed inside the phagocyte. Then the lysosome fuses to this phagosome to form phagolysosome. So what are these lysosomes? Lysosomes are organelles that contain an array of enzymes capable of breaking down all type of biological polymers. Okay, so they are enzymes which help in breaking down or killing or destroying the microbial cell. And last step in phagocytosis is after releasing these enzymes, killing and digestion of the pathogen will take place. So now these pathogens are developed such that they can block any one of these steps in phagocytosis. So now we will be studying about these strategies used by these pathogens for escaping the immune response. Okay, so as we had studied that first step in phagocytosis is making contact with microbial cell. Okay, so this strategy is avoiding contact with phagocytes. The bacteria will try to avoid making contact with phagocytes. So how this is how pathogens are able to do this? They will invade or they will remain confined in areas or regions where phagocytes are inaccessible, where they cannot go. For example, internal tissues such as lumen of glands or surface tissues such as skin, where phagocytes are not present or they do not do patrolling. Okay, next is they avoid provoking an overwhelming inflammatory response. So what is meant by inflammatory response? When a tissue is injured by bacteria, it releases chemicals and these chemicals causes blood vessels to leak fluid into the tissue. So these blood vessels will leak the fluid into the tissue, which will result in swelling. Okay, so they will avoid making this inflammatory response. Why? To avoid the attention of phagocytes. To avoid the attention of phagocytes. So some pathogens, they induce no response or they will induce minimal response. So the phagocytes will not make contact with the pathogen in that region. Okay, next is they will inhibit phagocyte chemotaxis. So what is meaning of chemotaxis? It is movement of cell, for example here phagocyte, in or other direction responding to the high or low concentration of a substance. Okay, so release of any substance by a pathogen will inhibit the phagocyte's chemotaxis. Okay, so for example, streptococcal streptolysin. So this is streptolysin is a substance produced by streptococcal species which suppresses the neutrophils in even in low concentrations. Okay, next is fractions of M tuberculosis, mycobacterial tuberculosis. They are known to inhibit leukocyte migration. Even Clostridium inhibits, it is known to inhibit neutrophil chemotaxis. Then next is they can hide the antigenic surface of cell. So some pathogens can cover the surface of the bacterial cell with a component which is seen as self by the host phagocytes and immune system. So phagocytes cannot recognize the bacteria upon contact, and the possibility of opsonization by antibodies to enhance the phagocytosis is minimized. Okay, so what these organisms will do? They will cover up their antigenic surface with any of the host cells or host fraction of substances or anything, that so that the phagocytes will recognize those cells or microbial cells, pathogens, as self, and the contact will not happen and possibility of opsonization is reduced. So what is opsonization? So opsonin is a molecule. It is any molecule that enhances phagocytosis by marking any antigen for an immune response. Okay, so example here is about Staphylococcus aureus. It produces cell-bound coagulase which clots fibrin on bacterial surface. So fibrin is from host tissue. So when phagocytes come to recognize it, they will recognize it as self because of fibrin and the contact is not made. In case of group A streptococci, they are able to synthesize a capsule which is composed of hyaluronic acid, which is also a part of host body. So the phagocytes will read them as self cells. So this is what we had learned about the first step of phagocytosis, how bacteria will avoid making the contact with phagocyte. Then second step in phagocytosis is engulfment. So the bacteria will try to inhibit this stage if contact is made with a phagocyte. They will try to inhibit engulfment. So they avoid engulfment or ingestion, as many bacteria bear surface substance that inhibit phagocytosis or adsorption or engulfment. For example, capsule. So here are some examples with bacteria. In case of group A streptococci, M protein and fimbri will protect them from getting engulfed. In case of pseudomonas, surface lime, which is polysaccharide, that will help it. In case of E. coli, O antigen associated with lipopolysaccharides will help E. coli to inhibit the engulfment stage. In case of Staphylococcus aureus, cell bound protein A will help it inhibit the engulfment. Then if engulfment also takes place, then it will try to survive inside the phagocyte. Okay, as we know, in case of phagocytosis, after engulfment, phagosome is formed and then phagolysosome is formed, where the bacteria or the pathogen is killed. So here we will study the strategy which pathogens has developed, which is surviving inside the phagocytes. The bacteria that can resist killing or and survive inside or multiply inside phagocytes are known as intracellular parasites. The environment inside phagocytes may help in early stages of infection or until they develop full complement virulence factors. The intracellular environment guards pathogens or a bacteria from drugs or antibodies or any other bactericidal agents. Okay, so why they would do this or they had developed for getting survived in phagocytes? Because the intracellular environment that can be useful for a certain pathogen to get protected from drugs, antibodies or any other immunological response. Okay, so how bacteria survives inside phagocytes? Either by inhibiting phagosome lysosome fusion, which results in phagolysosome formation. Okay, so either they will inhibit the phagosome and lysosome fusion. How and why? To prevent the discharge of lysosomal content into the phagosome environment. Okay, so as we know, lysosome contains an array of enzymes or granules which are used in killing or destroying the pathogen, so that they will prevent getting that granules or enzymes to be discharged in phagosome environment. Specifically, phagolysosome formation is inhibited. Okay, sorry. For example, Salmonella, M. tuberculosis and Chlamydia are known to use this strategy of inhibition of phagosome lysosome fusion. Another strategy is survival inside the phagolysosome. So even if the phagolysosome is formed, they can even survive inside that. How that is known little, but it may be due to the surface components of bacteria or due to the extracellular substances that they produce, which interferes with the mechanism of phagocytic killing. Next is about escape from the phagosome. Okay, so this point should be before the first point. It should come before the first point of inhibition of phagosome lysosome fusion, but never mind. You can write this in your answer first. The escape is essential for growth and virulence of some intracellular pathogens. Okay, so if they get escaped from phagosome, so it is essential. Why? Because it will help to grow and spread their virulence factors. This strategy is used by rickettsia, which produces phospholipase enzyme that lies the phagosome membrane within 30 seconds of after insertion. Okay, so here the enzymes are known to act on the phagosome membrane, and thus after lysis the rickettsia is known to get escaped from the phagosome. So this takes place within 30 seconds after they are ingested. So next is products of bacteria that kill or damage phagocytes. Okay, so this is the another point. This is not related to the what we can say the steps included in phagocytosis. This is the extra point we can say. As we all know, bacteria are known to produce many substances, even we can say enzymes or toxins, etc. So they can harm these phagocytes. So agrazins are produced by bacteria that causes damage to phagocytes. Mostly they are extracellular enzymes or toxins. Okay, so they can harm or kill the phagocyte before ingestion or after getting ingested. So first we will see killing of phagocytes before ingestion. So gram-positive pathogens are known to produce extracellular enzymes which are nothing but hemolysins. Okay, so for example, the pathogenic streptococci, which is known to produce a hemolysin known as streptolysin O, it binds to the cholesterol in the membrane. This is the host membrane. They will bind to the membrane and it will bind to the streptococci membrane, and when it gets in contact with the phagocytes, it will induce the release of lysosomal content and cause subsequent cell death. Okay, so this is the one strategy used by streptococci. In case of Pseudomonas aeruginosa, the bacterial extracellular protein, which is exotoxin A, it is known to inhibit the phagocytosis. Okay, so there is one more example, leucocidin, which binds to the receptors of the neutrophils. Okay, and thus it will block the contact and the neutrophils will get killed. Next is killing phagocytes after ingestion. Okay, so pathogens can grow inside phagosome and they can release the substances that can pass through the phagosome membrane, which will cause the lysosomal granules to discharge. Okay, so make a point here, discharge or release of lysosomal content is main step. So this can happen when pathogen is ingested, or this can happen when it is not ingested. So it just wants phagocyte to release the lysosomal content and gets killed. Okay, examples of killing phagocytes after ingestion are mycobacteria, brucella and listeria. We had completed our first point, which is overcoming host phagocytic defense. This is the second point under evasion, which is evading complement system. Okay, so as I had mentioned before, there are two pathways. One is classical pathway, which is mediated or which is triggered by antibodies on bacterial surface, and there is alternative pathway, which is triggered by polysaccharides. Okay, so to get protection from these complement systems pathway, bacterial capsules play a vital role. Capsules help to hide the principal target in gram negative, which is lipopolysaccharides. So they help to hide the lipopolysaccharides or peptidoglycan, which can induce the alternative pathway. Okay, some bacterial capsules are able to inhibit formation of C3b complex on the surfaces, thus avoiding C3b opsonization, further formation of C5b and membrane attack complex on the bacterial cell surface. Okay, so what are these C3B, C35? These are steps in the complement system. You can study them later. So next point is modification in lipopolysaccharide. Okay, so bacteria can avoid having these complement systems by modifying their lipopolysaccharides. As we had seen that lipopolysaccharides, they induce alternative pathway. So modifications in lipopolysaccharides such as attachment of sialic acid residues to the lipopolysaccharides O antigen, they prevent the formation of C3 convertase. Okay, so if one step is missed in these complement system pathways, then the bacteria will escape from getting lysed. Okay, so examples are Neisseria meningitidis and Haemophilus influenzae. The next main point which we will be covering is the third one, which is avoiding host immunological responses. Okay, so when a bacteria is invading or it has invaded epithelial surfaces, then the first antibacterial immune defense which will be shown by epithelial cells is having secretory antibodies, which are IgA, immunoglobulin A. When the bacteria it is able to penetrate or cross this epithelial surface, then it will encounter the following immunological response, which are inflammation, complement, phagocytosis, antibody mediated immunity and cell mediated immunity. So what are these? These are defense mechanisms by host. So in case of epithelial cell, IgA will work, and when this epithelial surface is crossed by the pathogen, it will encounter either of these mechanisms by host. But bacteria are known to evolve rapidly and have anti-host strategies. So what are these anti-host strategies? Let's study them. First is immunological tolerance. Okay, so what is tolerance? And it is showed by host. Okay, remember, the tolerance is showed by host. So there is an immunologically specific reduction in the immune response to a given antigen. So this is meant by tolerance. So there is antigen present in the host system, but the immunological response is reduced to that particular antigen. This is what is gaining tolerance to that antigen. So this tolerance facilitates the process of infection. So this will help to spread the infection. So what are ways tolerance, which ways by which tolerance to an antigen arise? These are fatal exposure to antigen, high persistent doses of circulating antigen, and mimicry at molecular level. So what do you mean by mimicry at molecular level? So the bacterial antigen will resemble as host antigen. So thus the immune response or the phagocytes will identify them as self, because the bacterial antigen is resembling to host antigen. Example, some bacterial capsules are composed of polysaccharides such as hyaluronic acid and sialic acid, so similar to host tissue polysaccharides. So they are similar to the host tissue polysaccharides, so that they are not immunogenic. So when the capsule of any pathogen is having hyaluronic or sialic acid, it will not provoke immunogenic response, because they are same or they mimics to the host tissue polysaccharides. Okay, next point is antigenic disguise. The bacteria may be able to coat themselves with host protein or polysaccharides. so that they are able to hide their own antigenic surface components from immune response. Okay, so what are the proteins that they can coat themselves? Examples are fibrin, fibronectin, and antibody molecules. In case of polysaccharides, sialic acid or hyaluronic acid are the examples. Next point is immunosuppression. You all know that immunosuppression is seen in the chronic infections. So here we are going to see about bacterial infection, and examples are leprosy and TB. Another example is HIV. Mainly the immunosuppression is seen in case of viral infections, okay, and rarely bacterial infection in case of bacterial infections. So rarely seen in case of bacterial infection. This means that host shows depressed immune response to antigen in general. Okay, so already the body is suffering from a chronic bacterial infection, so the immune response to any antigen in general is low. Okay, so there is a depressed immune response, including those of infecting pathogens. Suppressed immune response are occasionally observed during chronic bacterial infections such as leprosy and TB. Next point is persistence of pathogen at bodily sites inaccessible to the immune response. So the pathogen will hide in such a way that they are inaccessible to the antibodies or even phagocytic cells. Examples are liminal surfaces of gastrointestinal tract, oral cavity and urinary tract, or lumen of the salivary glands or mammary glands. These are some examples where antibodies or phagocytic cells they cannot reach. Next is induction of ineffective antibodies. Okay, so this point, it means that antibodies will be induced but they are ineffective. In case they will have the ability to bind that antigen, but the ability is very low, so they are ineffective. Okay, so many types of antibodies are formed against antigen. Antibodies tend to range in their capacity. Okay, so this is the capacity they are talking about, having the lock and key model or binding to the specific antigen. So this is the capacity they are talking about here. So antibodies tend to range in their capacity to react with the antigen, which is ability to specific antibody to bind antigen, which is known as avidity. If low avidity antibodies are formed, or if they are directed against unimportant antigenic determinants, they may have only weak antibacterial actions. Okay, and these are the last two points. First is antigenic variation. Okay, so let's assume there is a known antigen for a longer period of time, and we will term it as A. So body is already having immune response against this A antigen, but now periodically there is a change in this antigen, so we will name it as B. Now the antigen is same, but there is a slight variation in that antigen. So in this case, the immune response which body has already induced against the A antigen will not work in case of B antigen, even though they are similar. Okay, there is slight difference, but still the immune response will not be effective in case of this changed antigen. Okay, so this is the periodic change in antigen that is undergoing antigenic variation. Example is avoid host immune response by changing from one type of fimbriate to another, and by switching the fimbriate tip. Next point is changing antigen between infection. So many pathogenic bacteria exist in nature as multiple antigenic type or serotypes, meaning that they are variant strains of the same pathogenic species. For example, multiple serotypes of Salmonella typhimurium based on differences in the cellular O antigen, cell wall O antigen, and flagellar H antigen. Okay, so there are many types of Salmonella typhimurium, strains of Salmonella typhimurium, which differ in any one of these antigens. Next is Streptococcus pyogenes. Around 80 different strains are known, which differ in the M protein of the cell wall. Thank you.